Hi, hi all. My name is Nicolas von Tottel, or also known as NicoDuck in the IRC channel. And as Florian has introduced me, I will give you a rather short overview on how to operate a VXLAN network. We have heard some options you have, mainly on the control plane side. And well, we operate one VXLAN network. When I say we, I mean Fastcom Manet. We are a small ISP in this area. We have two data centers. We have a carrier hotel in Mannheim, around 12,000 kilometers of 12,000 square meters of route area, and 1,500 kilometers of fiber. We are mainly in the southwestern part of Rhineland-Palatinate, not far from here, but we obviously got connectivity to Frankfurt, of course. If you want to do a VXLAN setup, you need to know what do you want to do, what is your use case, why do you want to do VXLAN, or a network at all where VXLAN might be an option. Where do you want to install it? Most of the time it's going to be in a data center, so there aren't so many space restrictions. But if you would like to use it more in a carrier backhaul network, then you have more like small cabinets, which might be a problem for you. What do you want to connect? Is it a customer you want to connect, or do you want to connect your own servers, which have a big impact on what you can do with your network and what you can't do? How many ports do you need? Normal question if you want to buy a new switch. And what bandwidth do you need is obviously also a question. And is your hardware VXLAN aware? Do you only want to run your backhaul network on VXLAN and have a VTAP directly on the switch, like Florian mentioned? Or do you want to terminate the VXLAN directly in the server like VMware NSX does or other SDN with OpenStack can do? Do you want to use it or not? When connecting clients, there are some options you have got. You can just connect one client, but do you want to connect it via layer 2 or layer 3? Usually, VXLAN is chosen when you want to have a layer 2 connectivity, but don't want to have spanning tree in your network. But how do you handle layer 2 redundancy to a client if there is no spanning tree? Single port connections are easy. Just take your switch, connect one client to it, and that's fine. But as always, if you've only got one cable, there isn't so much which can go wrong. If you want to have redundancy without running spanning tree, it gets a bit more trickier. LACP can help, known as multi-chassis lag in that configuration, which is supported by some vendors. And it looks like a nice reason, nice possibility to do. With VXLAN, since you've got equal cost multipathing, packets coming in from both sides to the switch, and is spread via ECMP, and therefore you need to have one IP per pair of switches you want to connect. And they need to have a kind of a peer link. You can see it over here. You've got the two switches now. They've got a peer link in between, which they use for state sync, mainly for the LACP connection. And they present themselves as one LACP target. So the redundant customer or redundant server you connect, it just looks like there is one LACP endpoint, which is in that case two boxes. And that works rather well. You will have one shared ECMP IP address, which is fine for the MLAG part, because that is exactly what you want to have. You want to have two links, which both gets traffic, and therefore the backbone connection, the underlay network for your VXLAN, also needs to spread it to the two boxes. This is nice if you can use the MLAG, but it gets a bit ugly when you can't have the traffic flowing over both of the two boxes. Now you've got a customer which wants to be single homed because it's cheaper for them or because they just don't need the multi-homing connectivity, which you still have got one VTAP IP per leaf pair, as said earlier, and the VXLAN traffic is still going to be spread via ECMP over the two boxes. So now half of the traffic comes in via the direct path, and half of the traffic is coming in via the indirect path, which needs to be redirected to the other path over the MLAC peer link, you initially only thought that it would be used for the LACP state sync and shouldn't pass traffic, but that's what's going to happen. This is also going to happen if a customer wants to have redundancy but can't do LACP. We've got a feature request with our vendor, which in this case is Arista, to support a second VTAP IP. So you could choose a VXLAN interface for the multi-homed customer is the shared IP and the single-homed customer, which is then bound to one device. Well, it hasn't happened yet, but if you've got this problem and you've got Arista devices, I would just welcome you to maybe join that request, and someday it hopefully happens. But until then, we might need to increase link capacity on the MLAC peer link and obviously keep it redundant always. This is, if you've got the MLAC setup, it's just not ideal if the customer can't do it or just prefers to do it in another way, which also happens from time to time. Documentation, just a short part. If you want to document your setup, keep it simple, I would say. Don't put too much information in the documentation you don't need. This is an example configuration for customer documentation. If you provide a service over that network and your documentation tool isn't VXLAN aware, you might not want to put all your backbone infrastructure into the customer configuration because that might change. So I prefer just document the edge port where the customer connects, the physical port, and the service, and the rest is just a bubble, because it might change, but it's going to be documented otherwhere, like your physical cabling in the data center is going to be. So what we choose is a rather textbook example. We've got two spine switches per data center. They just do the normal IP routing for the VXLAN stuff. We've got dedicated leaves for all connections leaving the building, because they have a bit of bigger buffer in them to just handle the speed differences between the inside connections, which are mainly 100 gig or 10 gigs towards the customer, and the outside connections, which could have all different speeds. The fabric is completely VXLAN-based. The external connectivity is mainly done via MLAC. Our provider backbone runs the usual mix of protocols and hardware, which most of the IFP do, so VPLS, MPLS, and routing hardware, and they all are fully redundant, connected to the leaves which connect in and out to the data center. We have got the full MLAC configuration, so some customers have redundant, some customers are not redundant, and have traffic going via the peer link, which is, well, as I said, not ideal, but that's what we've got for now. And we decided for a controller-based setup. Florian mentioned that you have nowadays the option to use EVPN as a controller to maintain the flood list and MAC address lists, but it wasn't an option when we initially installed the hardware because EVPN at Arista wasn't that far developed. So we needed to choose, do we want to manually update flood lists on all devices all the time, or do we want to use a controller? And we went for the controller. Most important thing with all hardware where you got, try to keep a lab, as always. You are going to run into issues. You are going to need to do troubleshooting. The lab is your friend, and it's good. It's similar hardware and software setup, a bit easier, a bit smaller, but basically the same. Big picture, how it looks like, what we did. We've got the outside world on top, the connectivity to IP services, to VPLS service and other stuff, which terminate on special leaves, as I said, for all lines connecting in and out to the building. We've got mainly pictured here two data centers with a rather similar setup. Both data centers have got the special interconnectivity leaf for everything between them and the outside world. They are connected directly, but they also have their connectivity to other means of connectivity to our network, like the VPLS. Inside, as I said, we are having the two spine switches per data center connected via 100 gig links, and the leaves in the MLAG connectivity down here with the 2x10 gig at the moment MLAG peer link. So connecting customers to that. Usually customers in a data center get one port per service, sometimes two if they want. We of course do per customer and per service segmentation. So if a customer books a fixed line to his office and a second line to his internet, he usually gets two ports, but we can also do it on the same port with VLAN tagging, depending on the technology the customer wants to connect. Florian said that you have got a couple of VNIs to take from per VLAN. Our scheme is quite easy. We've got just the VLAN ID plus 100,000 to keep it simple, because therefore it's easy to see when you do lookups if it's right or wrong. You, at the VXLAN stuff, you can have a look at your VXLAN MAC address table, but also at your physical MAC address table on that host. You sometimes need to know the VNI which you expect, and plus 100,000 is just easy, and it just leaves enough room for everything we might want to do. We prefer MLAG redundancy when the customer wants to have it, but that's kind of tricky. When the simple configuration for a normal port and a VXLAN is looking like this, fairly similar to everything else you saw. You've got the VLAN, gets a name. You've got the interface. The interface gets a name and the VLAN ID attached to it. And down there, you've got your interface VXLAN configuration, where you said that the VLAN 539 is mapped to 100,000 539. Since we are using the Arista stuff, I can put this configuration in a central management, keep it all together, and apply it to the switch where I want to have it applied. Of course, port security not in, is not shown here, just to keep it a bit simpler and not to put up a wall of text. MLAG connectivity is, of course, a port channel per port, like I said earlier. I take the port channel ID from the physical port, and it afterwards looked like this. Still similar and easy setup. Got your VLAN ID, got the physical interface with the port channel group. In this, it's 100 plus the physical port, so 103 for Ethernet 3. You've got the port channel 103 now with the VLAN on it, and I say MLAG 103, which is also an arbitrary value, but it needs to be the same on both switches. So I just take the same as a port channel ID, just to keep it simple, and if the pager goes 3 a.m. in the morning, I still know it's the right or wrong number. Florian also mentioned that you don't need to have the VLAN mapped to the same VNI on both ends, so sometimes it happens that a customer wants to have a connectivity with his plain VLAN, where we can't just do a .1Q tunnel as we usually try to do. We just assign an own VNI ID range, like 200,000 plus the customer VLAN ID, and then map it to the respective port where he wants to connect. We also use this mean to translate VLAN on one switch to another switch to different VLAN IDs. Some customers have dedicated switches where we just use the 200,000 and their normal VLAN ID, but then they might order a shared service which is terminated on another switch where we need to translate it. But it's no problem, we just choose another VLAN ID on the far end switch and do port channel, the translation on the trunking port. So the main difference here with the customer VLAN is that it's the 200,000 plus the VLAN ID. So it's big enough for every customer we currently get. Yeah, I said that the MLAG setup is depending mainly on what's really getting connected to your network. If the device handles LACP well, it's fine. If it's not handling LACP well, it's not that fine. So have a look what really gets connected in our data center from the customers. So the main thing are non-enterprise switches, like the normal GP Cisco Small Business or HP Aruba-based switches, which can't do MLAG. Some can do LACP. So they could do LACP to one of their switch and another LACP to another of their switch, but therefore they would need four ports, which is going to be a bit expensive for most of them. So we can't use the LACP there. The second most thing which gets connected are directly their firewalls. And as most of you know, firewall people have got their own idea how they handle redundancy. They don't do active-active and they don't do MLAG, and they mostly do active standby and they just move the MAC address or cluster IP address to a secondary device. So no MLAG there. The third most common thing which we've got is IP-based storage. And unfortunately, the IP storage or at all storage guys don't prefer MLAG that much too. They usually argue that iSCSI is a better protocol to handle redundancy than all the Ethernet stuff which they don't really understand. And the fourth thing is HCI hardware like Nutanix, VMware, or what else. And they sometimes can do LACP and therefore connect to our MLAG, but most of the time they try not to do and prefer the MAC address to port binding, which means that the four most devices connected to our network all don't do MLAG, which just leads to a lot of traffic on the MLAG peer link. So if you're planning for VXLAN deployment, really need to think about if the hardware you're going to connect can do it or not. Pitfalls with the VMware, with the VXLAN stuff. Configuring VLAN only on one device. You would think that having a single port connectivity to a customer who hasn't booked the second port just needs a configuration on that device, which is not right because the devices of every device of the pair where only one switch has got the connectivity to the VLAN needs to do needs to know the VLANs. So over there, the left switch has got the configuration, the right switch, but also needs to know the VLAN ID. Until then, there's no traffic flowing. So you always need to apply the VLAN to both switches, even for single port connectivity. The XLAN controller, if you happen to not run EVPN because it's too new for you or not qualified for your software, you might want to choose a controller-based setup to just not have to manually update the XLAN IP flood lists and mappings on all devices, which can be quite painful after 10, 20, 30 devices. So you might want to do the controller. It can also help a bit with reducing broadcast and multicast traffic because they don't need to send it everywhere, but only where a device is connected. And they say that it has an automated fallback if the controller is unreachable. So we have got three devices or N devices all connected to the VXLAN controller. Every device sends its VNI and MAC address mappings to the controller, and the controller then distributes it to everyone else. So every device knows where the client they want to talk to is connected and where they need to send the IP traffic to. The VTAP and VNI learning to the controller is the most painful thing if you want to do it manually. So the controller pushes the flood list to the connected device. The device holds their connection when the connection drops. So all that's fine. But now one device goes out. The device itself is still online, but can't the controller reach the controller anymore. So the controller now sends out a message to everyone that the device is gone, although it still is available on the backbone, which doesn't affect unicast traffic because the devices still hold their MAC mapping, but broad and multicast traffic is dropped because the flood list is now missing the device, which is quite interesting if you're debugging it. MAC learning on the control plane is a similar story. It's mutually exclusive, at least at Arista devices, with data-based MAC learning. It fails over to head-end replication, so it just spreads to everyone it knows in the flood list to find out where the MAC address is. But again, you've got two devices which fail to connect to the controller because of reasons. And now these two devices are partially isolated. The controller sends out the message to everyone else that this device, that these devices no longer have any MAC addresses, or the devices are not known. So these two devices fail back to head-end replication because they can't reach a controller anymore. The device on the right is doing the controller-based MAC learning, and therefore they can't talk to each other. Even if the left device is sent traffic to the right device won't learn their MAC address because it's still connected to the controller. Well, there is no kind of half-broken. It's either completely or not broken, which is also... If your controller are not fully redundant, this is going to be really painful, like a split brain in the data center. In both data centers, it's working, but the connectivity between them fails. Yeah. The non-isolated device does not fail back, so it ignores all head-end replicated traffic because it just doesn't know the destination. So how do you mitigate it? You really need to make sure that your controller is fully redundant and don't use management ports or whatever. Even if the management port is the first thing connected to your device, it's not redundant. Don't use it for that. The best practice is to use InBand via BGP to just connect the controller to one of your leaves or spines via BGP, tell the prefix everyone, and have the connectivity fully inbound. If the inbound connection of a switch drops, it can't do anything because it's completely isolated. But if you do it over the out-of-band, then the inbound is still working, but no MAC has been learned. So you've got a partially isolated setup, but no traffic is flowing, although it was fully redundant. I would say treat it like God. It's really important for someone. So conclusion. It's not that hard to run the VXLAN network. The biggest part is getting all the IP stuff set up and the VNI mapping, which is, I would say, not that hard. Find out if you really need and want to have MLAG set up, because it's otherwise going to give you a bit of traffic you don't want to on that peer link. And make sure your control plane, whatever it is, doesn't include a single point of failure. If you're running the controller and not eVPN, make sure that the controller is reachable via inband and fully redundant. Questions?
So, well, okay. Thank you very much. Are there any questions? Please raise your hand.
Yes, regarding the requirement for MLAG peers, is there any time frame or something where you would implement the eVPN multi-chassis or multi-homing extension, maybe?
Oh. Wolfgang, we need a microphone.
I can only speak for the Arista side of things, and yes, it's coming soon-ish.
Soon-ish. But it's like be eVPN.
It's on the roadmap.
That means we could lose the MLAG and
yes.
Everything. Okay, good.
So, any more questions? It looks like if there are no more questions, thank you very much for both speakers.
Thank you.
And,